Second is what, there's a volume that what used to happen 10 or 15 years ago. I'm dumping 5 gallons a minute, but it's for 30 minutes. Now, we are addressing the volume problem, we're just making it on. The one thing I can't control and address is the soil infiltration. And there's not much to do with that other than what we are proposing to do with the amended soil backfill and something that's going to retain more water, soil release, it's going to improve water quality, all the things that we want to do, except for the water.
Does the property that was recently sold, it was an older property, they actually had to put in a system as well, and they had to, so I think it's the, I forget what number it is, it's closer to me, it's the backup tanks, I can't remember. But they, before that property could be sold, they had to put in a very expensive system, and they had to comply with these rules. So
for stormwater?
For septic, and I guess for stormwater as well, because he wasn't able to sell it until he did that. So that's where some of this we know what you mean.
Let me provide a little clarity, and maybe Mr. Hoagland can help because I don't have a fixed design, just a conceptual discussion with that. But what they're proposing, or what I believe they're going to send back to me as a proposal, it's not that they're not doing anything about stormwater. As a matter of fact, it's not even that they're getting out of doing something for stormwater. They're still talking about building in a stormwater detention basin. The difference is they're talking about trucking in amended soils. These are specially designed soils. And then incorporating sort of a French drain system under those soils so the stormwater filters through that amended soil media and then slowly goes out through a 2 or 3 inch orifice. So that when that storm, that deluge that we have on Monday, you know, when that thing gets.
Yeah, I mean, our road goes underwater fairly regularly.
Yes, it does.
Down here where I live.
When that deluge hits, that's not all running right into the creek. His plan is to capture that in the basin and let it out over a period of more than 24 hours to meet the water quality requirements. So he's still got to, from this simple way to say it, they've still got to spend a good bit of money on stormwater management. They're not getting out of that. The only difference is they're actually probably going to have to spend a little more money because they can't just infiltrate that water. If you can infiltrate the water into the soil, that's actually the least expensive option.
I know how high that water can get because the land across the street, which I own, my house, which is, has been a couple years ago, about four, I forget which storm it was. But that was completely underwater by not just a couple feet, it was pretty high up. All of the property next used to be sort of a barn at the Barrett's house. I forget what their number is. It's the old Waitstone farmhouse, right above, it goes right against the road. All their farmland was completely underwater. That 100-year flood is kind of a misnomer because it comes past that 100-year flood line if you look on the FEMA map. And so I don't know how far up it would really come during one of those. Yeah, because I see the lines, but I know where it physically was during, and I think that's right after Sandy.
We're talking about the flooding of Burke Hill.
Can you show us where on your plan the 100-year flood plain line is?
Yeah, I'm not trying to be a pain in the neck.
No, I just have a question. 100-year flood plain is here.
Yeah, so that's from there.
Our stormwater basin is here, and as a point of reference, we are about 20 feet above in elevation.
And that's the future home site.
This is the future home site.
Right. So in layman's terms, then, the applicant can catch the water he needs. He just can't get rid of it in the 72 hours.
He can catch the water he needs. He can't put push it down into the ground. He can't add it to the groundwater, so he's going to let it go into this amended soil and then slowly go out to the underground.
You do not have your design yet for your septic system, do you?
No, we do not.
Right, so you have to play with that a little bit too.
We have plans that we're going through right now. And that design, honestly, that when we get the planning and approval through the plan, the design won't be done until the actual house, once they have the architecture for the house, and only the bedrooms in it.
I understand that. Now, with fitting your stormwater control and your septic system, you'll be able to meet compliance because of the size of the ground and keeping your wellhead out of the floodplain area. You do have sufficient area there for drilling a wellhead.
We do.
Okay.
We do. And actually, we located the well, we have one of the comments in the letter this week, that we have an approved location, but at this time, we're trying to put the well. Let's see if I can pull this. It's up here, in this area, in front of the house. The septic is actually back behind the basin. We're trying to keep it up.
I guess you're just going to have to, ideally, you're going to have to, trying to call the words. I think you're going to have to carefully articulate how you're doing that, or describe how you're doing that, so that you don't raise additional concern on the street, I mean on the block, because people are concerned that this will change, you know, especially the stormwater function. The septic is going to make people even more agitated. I'm not coming up with good adjectives today. Yeah, they're going to be more anxious about that because, again, because the pergium is right there and it comes up pretty darn high, just like yesterday.
Well, I mean, if we do, recommend approval, there will be contingencies that are the things that are in Carol's letter. My point was, I feel more comfortable when these things have been done already, as opposed to just leaving it to another group of people to enforce those contingencies.
Yeah, I can.
Because I think those things should be hammered out here, right, and not later on in a different form. That.
Because does the well and the septic, they have to have a setback from the side yard and the front yards too? And between the floodplain and how far you have to be from certain things, you're even though it's a 4-acre track, you've essentially almost dropped it down below the 8,000 square feet limit that you're allowed for 2 acres. Right. That's the current law, 8,000 square feet, about 2 acres for R1. And if you chop off the floodplain, which you're not allowed to build it, and then come from each of the sides, you're running out of real estate, even though it's a reasonable sized parcel. I mean,
what does the number end up being when you develop the whole area?
2.56 acres. 2.56 acres. Two point five six acres.
Yeah, I knew it was.
And it's only, I mean, this is almost a moot point.
Right.
When Mr. Knight bought the property, he actually bought 2 developable lots. And it's been so long ago we have to go back for and we didn't re-subdivide like that. But that was the intent 30 years ago. For 2 lots there. So
30 years ago that couldn't have been the intent because back 30 years ago all the lots there they were subdivided all at the same time as well between 10 and 12 acres and there was no, that's because at that point in time that wasn't zoning in that area of 10 acres to build a house. And there was a single subdivision from the homeowner who owns that house, the Barnett's house, that's like 2 doors down after you have a little. The elderly woman was who sold that. They were all split into 10 and 12 acres. You know, they're all at least 10 acre lots. So there was no 4 and 6 acre lots. It's theoretically possible that what I read in the books was wrong. But
I mean, I'm not wrong. I have the record plans to show that. I mean, just to tie it back.
Yeah, yeah. That's the point. Well, I was contesting the statement that there were 6 and 4 acre lots back, because they wouldn't get developed.
Right, yeah.
All right, that's irrelevant for the discussion.
Yeah. As far as I understand it, going back to the stormwater, I don't know if anyone understands it differently, but what I understand is the applicant has done his due diligence and tried to make this work. He has engaged a professional engineer to certify the conditions at site, so it's not like he's just walking in here and saying my soils are no good and cut me some slack. The applicant has worked with our engineer. My concern is that primary concern would be, does he have enough facility there to capture the water? It takes longer to get rid of. All right. But the capturing water, in my mind, is probably the most important thing, unless I understand it correctly. So I'm not personally struggling with, I personally feel that I could support a waiver on that one.
I kind of feel the same way, with the exception that perhaps you don't have a septic system design, and you're telling us, in essence, that this stormwater detention facility that you're planning on here is going to discharge water. Now, how will that impact the septic system that you choose to put on the site? I think that's a legitimate concern, and perhaps, you know, there needs to be some kind of acknowledgement between your engineer for the septic system that, you know, hey, listen, if you're going to be discharging stormwater across an area where we plan to put our septic system, that may not work for us. I mean, I would not feel comfortable, you know, saying at this point or feeling at this point that that's an acceptable solution. So that's a concern of mine. I mean, I don't have any problem with you doing a system that's designed to, you know, improve water quality, as Carol outlined to us and so forth. But I do feel strongly that, you know, without having a defined septic system, which is integral to making that auto land work for a residential home, you know, that you also make sure that that's acceptable to how you're planning to move that stormwater during such times that you're going to be, you know, placing it in the area where that septic system eventually would go. So I don't know if others feel the same way, but I think that's a legitimate concern.
Mm-hmm. Our stormwater design is it's laid out so it doesn't discharge directly over the septic tank. And beyond that, one of the designs that we're integrating in is allows us to try and get the water to duplicate what happens right now, the sheet flow. So what it's going to do, it discharges the stone bed subsurface and slowly percolates back up and sheet flows off the site. And that's something also that works with the engineer.
I can say is where I live is pretty unique in the fact that I live in an area that is comprised of lots that are approximately an acre and a half up to about 4 acres. Every lot on my street has really no stormwater control at all, and I've always said that if I had to build my house today, I'd never be able to build it because of that. Water comes down from the top of the hill. I live above Silver Road, which is off of Memorial, right at the edge of Swamp Creek. We have horrific waters that come down across there. They cover everybody's property when they come down from the top of the hill. All of us, believe it or not, have septic systems that comply with the soils of conservation. Believe it or not, we're all in-ground pressurized systems. They all function perfectly. We all have wells. My well's about the shallowest. It's 135 feet. It yields approximately 35 gallons a minute. That's in Diabase. We're right on the edge of it. All the other people have wells similar, but a little bit deeper than mine, and go as deep as 400 feet based on where they lay. Believe it or not, everything seems to work pretty perfect right there. A house was just sold. And that house was sold in a matter of a couple of weeks, and it was sold for over $500,000. So people came back there and looked at it. I guess they looked at the other one. It was a pretty believe I have some faith in what you're proposing to us, and I wish the Nets good luck with this plan.
Any other discussion? Let's just go through the list of what people have to talk about. So the first waiver requests, look back up. Everything in Carol's letter is a little comply, with the exception of the five items that are in the crossroads letter.
Right.
It's under my understanding. So the first one is the clear sight process. Section 145.7. Does anybody feel have any strong feelings on that one? Second one we talked about, infiltration and stormwater. Anything that has not been talked about? Third one, widening the road to 24 feet. I don't think it's a good idea. Traffic, narrow streets, traffic calming. It's probably better to keep it narrow, to be honest with you. Knowing that road, that kind of the road, too. I hope there's anybody who has anything to talk about that. Sidewalks? None that we talked about there. And the street trees? Basically, you're saying you want to leave what's there because they're good quality trees. And therefore, you're asking for a waiver.
That's true.
Personally, it sounds like a good thing to me.
I agree.
Is there anything that anybody wants to add before we make a motion? Does anybody want it?
Well, I'd like to make a motion based on the letters that we have from the Crossroads Group and Carol's comment from Value Engineering that the issues of where there are will complies and that they can be that we can forward this to the Board of Supervisors to with our recommendation based on what's written here that we support both commentaries from Crossroads and from Value Engineering.
So we're looking for, I think the way we've done this in the past, these minor issues.
Right, right.
Is that what we've done in the past?
Yes.
So you're at that to recommend?
Yes, I'll recommend.
So you want to recommend the waivers as a separate motion, or are you doing them integral with it?
I guess we put it together unless you want to do it separate.
Probably.
You know, put them together. Do it as one.
Yeah, I'll make a second on it, but I would like to stipulate that if the applicant cannot meet those things that are in Carol's letter, the satisfaction of our engineer, that I don't think it's fine.
That's fine.
And, you know, that needs to make clear, hopefully in our minutes. I thought I had written a very clear email and taken time off on my work day before last board meeting and was dismayed to see the prolonged discussion and confusion that ensued. That's why I'm trying to avoid that in this instance and in future instances. But I feel very strongly about that, and I don't want people to say, oh, you gave us approval, and we're giving you approval based, it's got to be understood based on these conditions. And I think that's usually what's said, but we'll make sure that's very clear.
And there's a will to reply.
Yeah.
Well, the way I do.
So, we got a motion. I made a second. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Anybody against? Matt, you are. All right, you're up. as I remember it when we talked last time, the thing was you were going to bring back color samples and we talked about the exterior.
What I brought back is a landscape architect did some renderings, what the rainbow might look like. Also has a color architect overall.
Thank you.